wish you all could have been there. You get a chance to catch one of the other crusades, praise God. But what blessed my heart so much was the simplicity of the gospel. It's a mystery, this gospel we teach, that a man would die for us. Hallelujah. And do you know our sweet Holy Spirit is not fickle? He had our preacher preaching on the blood of Jesus, and that is what he preached on, was the blood of Jesus and the preciousness of the blood of Jesus. That, see, the Father is the one who basically makes that decision. God chooses the Father for his bloodline to pass down to his children. And the Father, Jesus, is God. That's why his blood is so precious, that it can wash away sins. Amen. The Lamb of God. Hallelujah. Oh, what a beautiful thing when you belong to Jesus. Hundreds and hundreds and hundreds, I am not joking, kept coming forth. It was incredible. We sang and sang and sang and sang as people were hungry for the Lord. Revival. Praise God. Amen. Wake up the church, Lord.
flesh and blood, the Son also became flesh and blood. For only as a human being could he die. And only by dying could he break the power of the devil, who had the power of death. Only in this way could he set free all who have lived their lives as slaves to the fear of dying. We also know that the Son did not come to help angels. He came to help the descendants of Abraham. Therefore, it was necessary for him to be made in every respect like us, his brothers and sisters, so that he could be our merciful and faithful high priest before God. Then he could offer a sacrifice that would take away the sins of the people, since he himself has gone through suffering and testing. He is able to help us when we are being tested.
In the glory, However, if you are a first-time visitor, at the end of service, the pastor and his wife would like to meet with you for a few minutes. The ushers will show you where to go. The mission, the vision, and the goal of the Upper Room Assembly is to see people's lives change by the power of God's word and by the power of his spirit. The mission, the vision, and the goal of the Upper Room Assembly is to see people's lives change by the power of God's word and by the power of his spirit. That's what he ended for the kingdom. The gospel of Jesus Christ be professed and proclaimed, and the kingdom of Jesus be enlarged. That's what we ended for. We're gonna discuss a little bit. Well, let me do this first. The offering bucket is in the back.
Right.
Those of you that worship here on a regular basis, you already know what time it is. Bucket is in the back. Those of you that are first-time visitors, we don't want to put a burden on you to give. If you feel your heart to give, so be it. But you can't leave here and say that, oh, they made me give my money. If you want to give, throw something in there. If you don't, be blessed. We want to discuss real quick. This is a stewardship moment. This is when we discuss what we are doing in the kingdom with our money. According to the Bible, Malachi 3:6, you know, it says a tenth of what we earn and make is the Lord's. That don't mean, you know, I'm feeling good today, I'm gonna hit them off, or, you know, I throw 20 in the pot. Nah, that means that I work a job and 10% of what I make, that's his. I'm holding that during the week. So when I get paid, I dump that off to him, that's his. This church here, I'm gonna talk about my own life. I'm gonna use my own self. I started coming here some years ago, been a while. I don't even remember. I know I was in prison and they used to come pick me up and bring me on passes. And I was, you know, serving the Lord, trying to do the best of my ability. And I met a lot of men and women of faith. And I seen how they operated with their money and with their finances. And coming out of prison, it was hard for me. And I had people in this room, some of them is here, some of them is not here, is investing money into my life because they believed in what the Bible said. They believed what the book said. So because they had faith and they had integrity to trust and believe what the book said, they invested money in my life. And what that did for me was when, you know, I got to a place where I did have a job, and I did have my own place to stay. You know, I tithe on a regular basis, and I still do to this day. My credit score, it might be 600, I don't know, it's in the 580s, something like that. But because the principles of the book, of the gospel of Jesus Christ, are true, and the promises in the book are yea and amen, as a result of me faithfully doing what I was supposed to do as a Christian man, you know, he enabled me and my wife to put 10% down on the house and to buy it. Like I said, the credit score is whack. So I can't say, oh, because I got a good credit score, I got a house. I can't say that. I remember the days when I didn't have a driver's license, when I didn't have a car. Brothers and sisters in this church would let me hold the vehicles to drive back and forth to suffer, to go to work. Wasn't even making 40 hours. But the blessing of the Lord maketh rich, and he had no sorrow with him. The blessing of the Lord maketh rich, and he had no sorrow with him. I'm telling you, the list can go on and on and on of the many stories and promises of how he has blessed me because I was obedient to something that was so small. 10 cents off a dollar, that ain't nothing. Go get you a credit card. You ain't gonna be paying back 10 cents on a dollar. That's all the king asked for. He said, if you make a dollar, give me 10 cents. You make 100, give me 10. That's what the king asked for. And that's not much. Go get you a credit card and then holler back at me. And then see what you have to say. But that's what the king asked for. And as Christian men and women of integrity, of honor, let us do what we need to be doing with our money. I remember when I was a young man living in the streets of New York, frequenting strip clubs and the clubs and whatever. And if you was cool with me, you was all right with me, we go in the club, guess what? I buy everybody drinks, I'm buying everybody drugs, I'm doing whatever I had, listen, I'm dumping it out, spending it all. Now as a Christian man in the house of God, embedded in the gospel of Jesus Christ, how dare I be tight-fisted with my finances? How dare I? But look, we ain't gonna go into that no further. Y'all know what time it is. 10% is his. Anything after the 10%, that's a gift, that's a blessing. And let me reiterate something else so you don't leave confused. We don't beg money here. The King of Kings and the Lord of Lords himself placed this ministry here. He placed it here. Brother Arthur Mitchell, the pastor, the congregants, whether we do what we're supposed to do or not, listen, the gospel of Jesus Christ is not going to stop. It ain't going to stop. Just real quick, just to reiterate about the leader of this house, the type of man he is. A lot of people don't even know, though, but they think they know. But it's all right. I'm going to tell you a little bit about what I know about him. It have been times in my life where the man has dumped hundreds on me, if not thousands of dollars. And at the same time, because he was a man of faith, trusting and believing in the gospel of Jesus Christ, he was like, yo, even if my family suffers a little bit, I'm trusting and believing that you are King and you are Lord and you're doing something special in that young man's life, so I'm going to invest in him. I'm going to invest in him. So he ain't perfect. Ain't none of us perfect. But I'm going to tell you what. He's a man of faith. He's a man of faith. And he's led by the Spirit. Led by the Spirit. So you're talking to one of the richest men in the world. Talking to one of the richest men in the world when you talk to him. You know what I'm saying? So don't be confused and don't let the enemy plant a seed in your mind against your brothers and sisters in the body of Christ. So a lot of things I don't understand, probably I'll never understand, but I do understand this. Jesus is Lord.
Yeah.
Jesus is Lord. Alright, we're gonna take up a lot of time. All hearts and minds on Christ, we're gonna pray. Father, in the mighty name of Jesus, I just honor and reverence you, Father, as King as Lord. And I just come before you as a humble servant. Coming for you, accessing that power, Father, that resurrection power, that Holy Ghost power, Father, that's still alive and well today. And I'm just praying, Father, that the house be consumed. Let the hearers be touched in their hearts. Let them be touched in their minds. Let them be touched in their bodies. As the pastor begins to speak and bring the words that are spirit and life, let them not resist these words and let them not see him, but let them see you high and lifted up, flowing in and through him. Anything in the house in opposition to the will and word and the gospel of Jesus Christ, you're rendered inoperative. All power and authority has been given to the name of Jesus.
Yeah.
This house is under submission and subjection to the Spirit and the Father. Let the power of the Holy Ghost flow through the pastor, overshadow him, and let him speak boldly and with clarity the gospel of the kingdom. In Jesus' name, it is so. Amen.
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 Amen. Come on, give the Lord a hand. Thank you. Thank you. One of the things Brother Arthur forgot to add in there was that he was a good investment.
Amen.
I've not always been a wise investor. I put some money in some programs and projects that didn't work out the way I planned on. I put some money in some things that seemed foolish and in the end it turned out that I'm a whole lot wiser than I thought. And I put some other money in some things that just went down the tank and you had to suck it up and drive on. But I'm going to tell you what, when you invest in another human life, when you invest in the salvation of a soul, yourself and the Lord a hand clap of praise. I salute you. Those who are the best in your lives. Amen. So we're going to talk a little bit. We're going to finish. No, we're not finishing. That's a lie. We're going to continue. All right? We ain't going to wrap it up today. The ladies, I actually snuck in the ladies' Sunday school this morning. If you've not been making it there, we're about filling the mind, ladies. I recommend you press out. Come on in a little early. Get here at 9:30 and get in the women's light room there Sunday morning. 9:30, they're talking about Battlefield of the Mind. And of course, I don't want Brother John to know. I missed the men's group and was hanging out with the ladies this morning. But as I begin to share some of what we're going to talk about today and through the rest of this series, one of the ladies said, Pastor Eric, could you break this thing down into some chunks and just do it for a couple of months? We'll pray about that. We'll pray about that. You tell me after today. Hit us up on Facebook, email me, call, text, whatever. Let me know after today, do you think this is something that we're going to need to explore a little more in the coming days? Amen? Amen. So we're going to compare and contrast today faith in Jesus Christ, lives transformed, the gospel of the kingdom, and we're going to compare and contrast it with some contemporary events we're seeing right now, and we're going to tie it into a historical perspective. One of the things I find often is that we lack historical perspective. And when people lack historical perspective, and there's an old saying, said those who don't know history are doomed to repeat history. Anybody ever heard that before? Amen. And so when you think about that, what it is if I don't know where I came from, if I don't know what's going on, I can't really grasp why I am where I am, and then I cannot see clearly where I need to go. Come on, somebody. You understand that historical perspective is important because humanity, the universe, that there's a resonating event, the return of Jesus Christ. So from creation to the return, there is no disconnect. Humanity's not disconnected. And so often the secular idea is they'll want us to believe in these different ages or periods when the dinosaurs and when the protozoan and the humans came and so they want to disconnect us from the reality of creation and God, who we are, where we came from, and where we're going. But I find that not only if we disconnect in that way, scientifically disconnect from creation and God, do we then devalue humanity. But if we disconnect historically from our faith, from God's movement, if we disconnect historically from the idea and understanding of the building block of society, which is man and woman and family, if we disconnect historically from those who have struggled before us, we find ourselves wandering, confused today, and we don't know where we're going tomorrow. I'm telling you what, if you don't get historical perspective, if you don't get a good overview of who you are, where you've been, where you're at, and where you're going, you're going to continue to wander around lost. You need to have eyes and ears. Jesus warned us of those who say, I see, but he said, you see not. Right. He warned us of those who say, we can hear. He said, but you hear not. And then he said this, he said, lest that they could see or hear, then I would come and heal them. There's a danger in thinking that you can really see what's going on in life. Don't see squat. And thinking, oh, I heard him, I got it. You ever had your kids do that? I heard you. They didn't hear nothing you said. They walked out of your presence and went and did what they wanted to do. There's a danger in saying you see and that you hear, yet see not and hear not. And I'm telling you that if you'll grasp a hold of the bigness of the kingdom of God, if you'll grasp a hold of the overarching, overreaching, life-changing power of the gospel, if you'll grab a hold of the historical perspective of where God has been, where he's at, where he's going, because you understand, he's outside of time. But we can only understand him in time because we do not have a mind capable of going outside of that. So if you're going to grasp a hold of God and where he's going in your life, where he's been before, where he's at now, and where he's going, is what you got to get a hold of. You've got to have a historical perspective, not only of your life, but of our faith, and not only of our faith, but of humanity. Then you can begin to settle down. Then you can begin to get a little peace. Then you can begin to be okay. Because if you can't get a more historical perspective, let me go ahead and just put it in a week-to-week basis. The other day, I heard someone saying that, come January, if I haven't done XYZ, something's going to happen. I got to tell you, I got to live it. I got anger. I got this righteous indignation rise up inside of me. And sometimes when I get righteous indignation, I get fleshly response. Come on, somebody. And it dawned on me as I heard this speaking that the person speaking had no historical perspective of what God had done for them in the past. What God was doing for them right now. And what God was going to do. You understand, even on a local level with your light bill, on a local level with your children and their salvation, on a local level with your job and your future and your hopes and your dreams, if you cannot get historical perspective, you cannot have peace or faith for the journey. You've got to get a hold of it. You've got to stir up the remembrance of all that God has done for you. Amen. So we're going to do a little open compare and contrast. And so what I prefaced this all on was the idea of an experience in God. Chuck, can we get some lights? I want to talk to these folks. Praise God. I want to have a heart-to-heart. So when we talk about Acts 1:8, it's the classic Pentecostal passage of Scripture. It's the classic verse that we stand on that gives credence to all that the Pentecostal doctrine talks about, experiencing God, speaking in tongues, word of wisdom, word of knowledge, prophecy, healing, everything that we all go back to Acts 1:8. I love the passage. Don't y'all love it? Amen. I mean, even if you came from a Baptist background, and if you came from a Methodist background, if you came from a nothing background like I did, I came from a stirring pot of a garbage background. I figured it out as I went along. I had a little complaint going in there, a little bit of radio, a little bit of HBO, a little bit of, my theology had come from nothing. But when I experienced the power of God, I was transformed. And so we hearken back to this as Pentecostals, as people and believers in the Spirit of God, as people who believe that God not only wants you to believe in him, but he wants you to experience him. We hearken back to this, and I love it, but you will receive power. Come on, somebody say power.
Power.
Don't you want some power in your life? Anybody ever feel powerless? You feel like life is whooping you? The devil's whooping you, your wife is whooping, you know what I'm saying? Yeah. And you ever feel like you just need some power in your life? Of course you have. Whether it's, because of my race or my gender or because of this, I'm being picked on, I'm being put down, I'm being shunned aside, I'm being bullied, everybody at one time or another feels powerless. Well, Lord, you know, I believe in you. No. The idea was that when you sought God, he was going to come and manifest. He's going to show up. Come on, somebody. I mean, when I didn't even believe in God, and God spoke like a bass drum spoke inside my belly, I wasn't a Christian, I wasn't nothing. I was a heathen first class. And yet God he spoke to me. And what he said was so amazing. Go get a job. Go get a J-O-B is what God told me. I'm like, I got a bottle of wine in my hand, I'm standing on the beach at night. I'm like, oh, okay. But you understand something, friends, brothers and sisters, you understand something, that when you've had experience, when power has touched you, I couldn't go, it didn't matter to everybody else, but when all my family thought, oh, you're nuts. Oh, God spoke to you like a bass drum in your stomach. That's what it is. Facing 40 years is too much for it. He's cracking under the strain. 17, 18 years later, I'll tell you what, I'm so glad I cracked under the strain of the power of God. I'm so glad that I cracked under the strain of the power of God. Because I've never been the same again. Huh? So my family thought I cracked, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be my witnesses. Ah, this is what we're going to compare and contrast now. You will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, in Judea, Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. That means there's nowhere left out for you. Amen. But see, this is what I've got to bring into the mix. And some folks are going to get offended today. Some of you are going to get happy. Some of you are going to challenge my facts. Some of you are going to go, oh, I already knew that. But I don't really care what your response is. All I want to know is that you've got ears to hear and eyes.
Okay. Amen.
So we're going to stop before I get fired up. We're going to pray for a minute before I get going. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
You see, this is just the introduction, you understand. We got some preaching yet to come. All right, I want you to know. So I think we need to pray corporately. We need to pray for each other. So let's do this. You reach behind you and grab one of their hands. They just touch. Everybody grab somebody's hand. Everybody's going to pray for somebody. You're not going to pray for yourself. You're going to pray for your neighbor. Somebody's going to pray for someone else. And we're all just going to pray together. Everybody close your eyes, bow your head. I don't want you, you know, just in case your neighbor's got B.O., I don't want you looking at it while you're holding your hand. Okay? You're going to love them anyway. All right. Lord, come on, say it with me, Lord, bless this person. Open their eyes so they can see you. Open their ears so they can hear the Spirit. Father, move with power on us today in Jesus' name. Amen. Glory, give the Lord a hand of praise. What it means to be a witness, to experience the power of God through the gospel of Jesus Christ, the kingdom of God, and to be a witness, to have the power, the life-giving power, the anointing, the new birth, whatever you want to call it, the transformation to become a Christian. Because you understand, becoming a Christian is not joining a church. Becoming a Christian is not just a set of mental beliefs. Becoming a Christian is being born again of the Spirit of God. It's having the old washed away and the new come in. It's having the power of sin broken and the power of God come. It's becoming a new creature, a new creation. We don't just mental ascend. We don't have to get on a rug and bow in a certain direction. We pray all day in the Holy Ghost. Come on, somebody. We can connect with God right here, right now. We have a direct line to the Heavenly Father through His Son, Jesus Christ. no other faith or religion that believes that. We're the only ones that believe that we can go right to God's throne and touch Him. That He can feel my burdens. He can hear my cries. He is touched by my tears. He feels my pain. We're the only people that God has said that I will not only walk among them, I'll be in you and be with you. There's no one else that gets that but us. And I'm going to tell you what, that's so good, I don't want just me and my family to have it. I want everybody. I want everybody to get some. Amen? Chase it. Oh, we didn't get there yet. Taste and see that the Lord is good. Ah,
Lord.
Look at this. Taste and see the Lord good. Blessed is the one. Y'all read that? You see that? Blessed is the one. It takes refuge. Now, this would be my question to you as we get ready to move on. Because we're getting ready to get into, I'm going to take this historical journey. Remember, later on, hit me up on Facebook, Twitter, email. You can even send, you know, like bad messages to my phone. I don't care. You know what I mean? I remember Pastor Alex, when I preached this one message, very similar to what we're going to preach today, about the gospel of Jesus Christ being the bringing the prosperity of God throughout the world. Then on YouTube, and it blew me up. You know, several people just attacked me. His facts are wrong, this and that. And Pastor Alex, just, man, he just went and Googled and researched, and he wanted to see and prove that all the things I preached that day were true. And all the facts lined up. And so he went back trying to answer every single critic. And if we're every critic, just wanted to be a critic. So they just kept criticizing every time he had an answer them. And I was thinking, I asked him one day, and I went on YouTube and saw like these 34 posts, but they don't argue with these people. And I said, Pastor Alex, what are you doing? Pastor Aaron, they're attacking you. They're saying that you're preaching lies. I said, yes. I love it. I said, don't answer them. Jesus went like a lamb, silent to the slaughter. I said, you don't have to answer your critics. The truth of what you live and preach will stand on its own. Your fruit will be known as the law. And I am not going to spend my time on the internet, anywhere, answering somebody sitting at home smoking a bong and just feel like they want to be in pain that day. Because I used to be that person. Goodness. Man, if we'd had Twitter back in the day, I'd have been all high and Jack Van Gundy would have been blown up every day. You know what I mean? I'd be calling him a heretic and a liar. Right? You ain't got time to spend on your critics. Spend time on the gospel of Jesus Christ. Spend time on the power of God. Don't worry about them. So some of y'all are going to get mad today. Y'all be like, I can't believe you preached that. And I'd be like, good. Go home and prove me wrong. Find refuge in God. Find refuge in Jesus Christ and prove me wrong. Because listen, if I preach something wrong, I want to preach right. I'm going to jump in there right now. I want to preach right. So if I'm wrong, I'll be like, come over here next to me. Oh, man. Sister Carolyn guys came in and said, Pastor Aaron, this is wrong. And I was wrong, man. I'm going to look it up. Amen? But if you ain't never been wrong, we're excluding wives and women today. Everybody else, you ain't never been wrong. But you know your wife ain't never been wrong, guys. Come on. Amen? Y'all want a nice lunch today. Your wife ain't never been wrong. Amen? My wife ain't never been wrong. I always tell her, how in the world you can be right every time, but you are. Right? Happy wife, happy life. You better believe it. So there's a sensory, there's a sensory perception that God is giving us here that we can taste and see. My goodness, do you know how much time we spend complaining and not tasting? Taste and see that he's good, but there's a piece in this puzzle that says that Aaron's got to look for my refuge in him. See, if I want to focus on my problems, I can taste and see that they stink. Bad news, good news, don't matter. Lots of money, no matter. Big house, small house, no matter. New car, old car, no matter. Full belly, empty belly, no matter. I can taste and see that God is good right now. That's something, listen, y'all don't understand the privilege. This is what it's all going to come down to. The privilege of having God reach out to earth and call to you through the blood of Jesus Christ and say, I love you, I want you, come to me. Yeah. And then have God save you, change you, deliver you. Oh my goodness. You know how blessed we are.
Amen.
How privileged. If you sitting here today are born again and saved by the blood of Jesus Christ, you know how privileged you are to be in a relationship with God Almighty, the maker of heaven and earth. Oh, yeah. We're talking about God. God. Let there be. That God. Oh, my goodness, man. I reduce it to the size of my problem sometimes. And I think he's broken down and crippled. I got a God that's on wheelchairs and crutches. But we're talking about God.
That's right.
We're talking about the one.
Okay.
Jehovah. Yeah. The very name means outside of time, without creation, eternal being. Think about that. That's what messes scientists up to this day. My goodness, you realize that the theory of evolution is not even a good solid scientific theory. But the alternative is that a God made us and they just can't consider it. It freaks them out. Wow! And we have the privilege of not only knowing him, but being his children. Not only being his children, but having his spirit. Not only having his spirit, but having my sinful nature broken and shattered by his love and power. And if all that wasn't good enough, what if we know? Now, all that would be enough if we even went to the grave and like they just covered us with dirt and that was it. But when they put this old body in the grave, we said, I got a promise from the Father that I'm going to rise again. I got a promise from the Father that I'm going to get up out of that thing. I got a promise from the Father that I'm going to have eternal life. And building me a mansion. And then he's even saying this. He's like, because when I get there, he's going to be like, remember that time you hooked old Arthur up? I'm going to hook you up, homie. I'm going to have like the baddest bicycle tip. Because if you can fly through walls and all, why do you need a car? You know what I'm saying? You understand, not only are we going to get eternal life, but we're going to get rewards. Oh, we don't talk about that much in church. He said he's going to reward us for what we have done. Oh my goodness, she's been married here for 50-some years. The rewards that woman's going to get. Glory! They're like a whole Paulette section of heaven, amen. He's already marked it off. He's planting flowers right now. And I'm going to come ride my bike in your garden. You understand this gospel is bigger than anything imaginable. It's not a religion. It's a life change. It's an eternity. We've got something that no one else has. Why aren't we sharing it with everyone we need? Oh, so I'm going to do a little compare and contrast. I told you all that. Now in 1 Thessalonians 1, Paul makes this neat statement about the Thessalonian believers there that I like to make about you guys. Paul. He says there, they tell me of how you turn to God from idols to serve the living and true God and to wait for his Son from heaven, whom he raised from the dead, Jesus, who rescues us. You understand that every person I've ever seen coming to the kingdom of God, every person I've ever seen born again, every person I've ever seen that God got a hold of, drew them in. Not only have I had the pleasure of watching their lives change, watching their marriages change, watching their finances change, not only have I had the pleasure of watching them find their gifts and their calling, watching them begin to serve their community and their king, watching them transform, but I get the privilege of knowing that that person who loves Jesus Christ is really just waiting for the moment to come. When the sky's going to split, the trumpet's going to sound, no! And he's coming back. You understand that all of history, from the garden to the end, is all about the prophetic return of Jesus Christ. It's all about the Son coming back. Every enemy will be vanquished. Every foe will be defeated under his feet. It will be his footstool, the scripture tells us. Now, I can tell you what, I was an enemy of God for many a year. But now I'm so blessed to have him call me friend. You understand that there's a testimony that has to go out. There has to be an ability for people to say, well, you know, she loves this Jesus. Someone said to me the other day, after picking on Brother George, I've got to go ahead and give him some praise. I met with someone the other day who's known him for years and years and years and years. And he went to church with him about 30 years ago. And they still go to that church. And they said to me the other day, I wanted to tell them to talk to God. They said to me, well, I hear that George Earl goes to the church. And I said, yeah, he's awesome. He's a good friend. And, and this was kind of like one of his awkward moments where we missed him. I was like, well, he's been gone 30 years. I'm glad you missed him. That tells me you love him. Amen. I didn't say that. No, I didn't say that. I said, well, that's so neat. I said, yeah, we love you. It's awesome. And then she said this. She said, you know, ever since he's been coming to your church, he's changed.
Hanker for peace. Come on, somebody. With the infidel, the head of them.
Catch that. Listen to that. There is this lie being perpetrated on Christians, on you and I, that, you see, Islam and Christianity, well, they both had their bloody period. It's, you know, Islam is just right now having a rough time. And Christianity was a bloody religion at one time, too. You know, the Crusades, the Inquisition. Well, I'm going to put the rest of that today. I'm going to begin to break down some of this truth on this one. Because there's a real problem with this situation. And the problem is this. That for 1,400 years, believers in Islam have been doing exactly this. But for 1,400 years, there's been a veil of deception on the people watching it take place. So when I say the Moors are at war, you all are thinking, well, who in the world are the Moors? Well, I want you to know who the Moors are. You see, because we get accused that the Spanish Inquisition was a bloody period of Christianity. Anybody ever heard of the Spanish Inquisition? Everybody ever heard of the Crusades?
Yeah.
This is so amazing. So I'm studying this all week, and I walk into the courthouse, and there stands one of our county commissioners, and we begin this nice conversation, and then he says to me, you know, he said, man, this is some bad stuff on the news, isn't it, Pastor? I said, yeah. He said, well, you know, we Christians, we had our bloody time, too. I said, we did. He said, yes, we did. You know, the Inquisition, the Crusade. I said, please enlighten me. Tell me about how bloody we were. I said, brother, you bring up the Inquisition, tell me about it. He said, well, I really don't know about it. I said, well, I've been studying it all week, and I tell you about it. You understand that the Iberian Peninsula, what we now call Spain and Portugal, was invaded in 800 AD. It was invaded by who? Well, history calls them the Moors. Why does history call them the Moors? I have no idea why history called them the Moors. Because who were they? They were in the Islamic army. And what were they doing? Beheading people and taking slaves. Why were they doing it? Because their book tells them to do it. You understand that when I saw this week, right on the news, and I just want to get y'all to see that what was, is, and is to come. That history has a timeline, and it is interwoven, and you can't separate. So when I began to think, as I was watching the news report this week, when they wouldn't even say that this was Islam or Islamic people doing this, well, that's not really Islam, the news wanted to say, I thought to myself, has there ever been a time when people would not call sin what it is? Has there ever been a time when people not call evil what it is? Has there ever been a time when people would make fake names for something so you couldn't really see what the real enemy was? And guess what? The first time they invaded Europe, they didn't call it Islam, they called it Moors. I thought, what in the world is going on with this? A veil of deception rests on this. You see, God is allowing Satan. Listen to me. You're going to get something. God is allowing Satan to bring a veil of deception for those who don't have eyes to see or ears to hear. I watched an interview with a man who's an atheist, a guy named Bill Maher, being interviewed by a gentleman named Charlie Rose, who's going to be one of the greatest interviewers. And Bill Maher looks at him because Jim Charlie Rose said, well, you know, Muslims aren't like this. This isn't real Islam. He said, yes, it is. It's what their book says, and it's what they've always done. Now, let me give you an example. Pastor Jared, draw me in front here. Brother John, draw me in front here. Let me give you an example of what I'm talking about here. You need to have eyes to see and ears to hear. So the Moors, you guys just hang out with me over here. Come on down here. Join hands. You know, wake up. Touch and breathe. The pastor will get to you in a minute. You understand that even at that time when they invaded Europe, there was this veil of deception of who the real enemy was. But the church, listen to me,
biblical Spanish Inquisition of bloody time? Yeah, because there's always idiots to get a hold of anything. But what was the Spanish Inquisition for real? Let me tell you what it was. It is the Moors pushed into the Iberian Peninsula as they took over. Anybody ever wonder why Spanish people in Spain, why the rest of Europe was like me? Come on, listen. Why does the rest of Europe look like me and the Spanish people have olive skin and dark hair? Have you ever asked yourself that? It's because they were invaded and taken over for 270 years by people who were from North Africa and the Middle East. You're not hearing me. So these people come in for 200 plus years and enslave the Christian nations of Spain and Portugal. So as Christianity decided it was going to push back. And so Christian kings throughout the European area began to join together and say, listen, we've got to do something about this. They take it over Jerusalem. They take it over North Africa. You understand that North Africa, from Ethiopia to Sudan, used to be the highest place of Christian thought in the world up until 700 AD. The first universities ever of the Bible were in Sudan, Africa. And now you can't find a Christian there to save your soul because they're being stomped out and killed, hunted down wherever they're found. Come on, somebody, you better get a hold of this. The finest Christian universities, the oldest Christian universities, Alexandria, Egypt, Sudan, Libya, gone, wiped out. Why were they wiped out? Because all of those Christian lands were invaded. You see, when Christians invade a land, we invade a land by going into a prison and say, hello, homie, you need Jesus. You need Jesus. We go find dope addicts, pimps, and hookers, and we tell them the gospel, and that's how we take over the land. All right. Amen. That's how we do it. Our tactics ain't changed a bit. We go into the heart, and we'll get the land. Their tactics ain't changed a bit. They go to your head, and they get the land. You ain't hearing me, people. You need to listen. This thing ain't new. That we ain't new to this. This has been going on for 1,400 years. But we sit and watch news reporters and presidents and senators who can't call it what it is. They're scared. There's a veil. There's a fear. We're fighting verses to tell them, listen, we're teaching our children to love and forgive and give. And they're teaching their children to hunt mine down and kill them. This is not new. But you, dear Christian, have to have your eyes open, your ears alert. You are in a war for eternity of souls. You already got Jesus, you're like, all right, we're good. Me and my family, we're good. We got Jesus. That means you better go find some other people who need him. You ain't going to blow yourself up down on a street corner, and I doubt you're going to cut anybody's head off. But you probably won't go tell nobody about your Savior either. See, they're going to win their way if we don't win ours. So the Moors invade. They enslave. They kill and they take over. Kings of Europe all over said, you know what? We got to push these people out of here. We got to push them back out of land because they're not going to give up. And they go on what? A crusade. A crusade to do what? So in your mind, what TV in school wants to teach you and your children is that Christianity was a bloody religion that just went on a crusade to kill people. So listen to me. How do I know that? Because I just talked to a pastor at the courthouse that told me that. You've been convinced of this and taught this lie. going to go rescue people who are being enslaved and their heads cut off. It does not make a bloody religion. Don't you dare equate the two in the way that they conduct the business. So Christian nations rose up and said, we're going to push you out, and they did. So what do you say? Well, then what in the world was the Inquisition, Pastor? I'm glad you asked, Brother Chris. I'd like to tell you that. Are you allowed to deny Jesus Christ and make it into heaven? Can you deny Jesus Christ and make it into heaven? Can any of you deny Jesus Christ when it comes time and make it into heaven? No, you can't, and we know that. We are not allowed to deny the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords because it's not this life we're preserving, it's the next life. But guess what they're allowed to do? They're told to lie about what they believe. They're told to lie about what their religion is. They're told to lie to deceive the infidel so they can get in. And we're not allowed to. Come on, somebody. It's the difference between light and darkness, truth and righteousness, and lies and deception. You understand that we're told to go and feed the poor, clothe the naked, and help the homeless. They come to kill, steal, and destroy. I'm lifting the veil of deception for a moment for you today. Understand the history you're fed by Christianity is a lie. So they are allowed to lie about what they believe. So Christian armies sweep back in, push the Islamic armies out, and all of a sudden, they've got to decide who's really Christian and who ain't. So they begin to inquire. An inquiry is an asking, an inquisition. So what do they got to do? They got to root out the imams that are hiding in the population that are still trying to pervert Jesus Christ in the gospel. So before the church would allow you to teach the children, to work in the nursery, to handle the money, to be a pastor, a bishop, a deacon, an overseer, you had to go before an inquisition. And if you were caught subverting the gospel, you were brought before the bishops for an inquisition. Now, there's a confusion between Queen Isabella and her court and what she did to people versus what the bishops did down in the villages inquiring of the faith. And if you take the two, because you understand there's no such thing as a Christian nation, there can only be Christian people. And so Queen Isabella used the Inquisition for her own political means. But Christian bishops down in the villages, down in the churches, down in the local assemblies like this, did what every Christian should do. They should test and see whether you're a Christ or not.
That's right.
And that's what the Inquisition was. To inquire of you where your faith is. Yes, Queen Isabella used the political means to do away with her political foes. But I'm going to tell you what, if it was allowed today, we would see the Democrats and Republicans use it on each other today. So I don't even need to tell them what politicians do. We know what they do. But the truth of your faith is, the truth of believers is, the truth of Christians is, that we've never changed because we can't change. What we do is give and love and forgive and feed and clothe. And the truth was, don't change. Because that's who we are. Not because we're great, but because He is great. Not because we got it all together, but because He's inside of us, putting us together. Coast Mediterranean, and the Gulf of Aden. Now, what you find is an amazing piece of history, and I'm sure you've seen this at home all the time. From the halls of Montezuma to the shores of Tripoli, we will find our country's battle on the land and air and sea. First to fight our nation. Why is Tripoli in that song? Because the Marines were sent to Tripoli to try to rescue American hostages who were being beheaded by a Muslim caliphate. They were taking our ships, as our ships go through, on journey to Europe, on journey to Africa, to bring goods and supplies. These nations would seize our people, and then they would behead some of them, send their heads back with a ransom note for the rest of them. Does it sound familiar to anybody?
Yeah.
Their tactics haven't changed. What they do hasn't changed. The first war this nation ever had to fight was because this is still the same. If you don't know your history, you don't know why we're where we are. So why did Thomas Jefferson say we're going to war against the Islamic states of North Africa? Why did he call them the Barbary Pirates? Because God is allowing a deception, allowing Satan to have a deception of the people, to not call it what it is. So our press will call it what it is today, Thomas Jefferson will call it what it was then, and back all the way in 800 AD, even Christian kings who went on crusade didn't call it us. Wow. Is that not amazing, y'all? That there's a spirit that does not allow this to be called out for what it is? So let me share a little with you. And oh, by the way, a little bit of a Western history. You understand that when America was founded, there was no slaves here. Right? Don't understand that. When the first Christians came here, they brought no slaves. There was no slavery. So how did all the slavery get here, you may ask? I hope some of y'all have asked that and looked into it. I'll give you a little bit of enlightenment today. Dutch traders ran into who? Islamic caliphates in Africa. What would those Islamic caliphates do? The same thing they're doing now. The same thing they just did in Nigeria when they took 300 little schoolgirls from a Christian school, and did what? Sold them as sex slaves. Today, that's happening right now. In the news. So you say, how in the world did a nation that was first founded by Christians who came here and wanted to be free to worship Jesus Christ, and there was no slavery here, how did they get here? Islamic caliphates taking tribal people. Because you understand something. I want to touch this just for a second. You understand tribalism is the weakest form of society. So whether it's practiced in Africa, or whether it's practiced here in America, or the Indian, whether it's practiced right now in Afghanistan, why is Afghanistan not a viable, strong nation? Tribalism. It can't. As long as there's tribalism, because tribalism says you and your clan are going to fight him and his clan, and y'all don't live 3 miles away. And so I always stay in a fight with you. I'm never strong enough to fight the enemies that come in from outside. All right, let me just give you the verse. A house divided. So the Islamic armies of Africa did what? They took advantage of tribalism. They would raid the tribal lands, seize the strong young men, and do what sell to the Dutch traders who come along the coast. We're still doing it this day. Please, people, wake up. Nothing has changed in the evil enemy that wants to crush, kill, destroy. So there, slavery was introduced to this nation. And I can tell you right now, there's a lot of people say, well, I would never do this, I'd never do that. You never know what you can do. We can all declare what we think we are. Without Jesus Christ, we are. Now listen. listed. So this Islamic force that has not changed for 1,400 years. It is what it is. It is an evil. But this is what's going to happen at the end, guys. You don't need to know this. See, now, of course, the Islamic force has had a hidden agenda, and I think Brother Chuck just showed that to y'all. Did you put the hidden agenda up there? Well, you understand that the end result is going to be this. That the book of Daniel, chapter 11, tells us there's going to become a peace in the world. Now, we're told that Ishmael and his life would be a warlike people who would not only fight his own, but would fight everyone else. So you see that Islam is an Ishmaelite religion. These things were foretold for not just centuries, but from the beginning of the world. So now we've got a case, we've got a situation where a people who have been warlike from the very beginning, the Bible tells us they're going to come to peace. They're going to come to peace with this group and that group. So when you begin to see Islam and Catholicism and Protestantism, and when you see a peace begin to form, when you see all these religions say, well, we're going to stop fighting, when you see Islam stop fighting and other peoples make peace with them, understand the end is at hand. Understand the end is at hand. But this is what I'm going to, this is what you got to understand. And we're going to talk about, go back to the open agenda. We're going to talk about this in a minute, but this is what you got to understand. That when they make peace, you become a man. Now listen up. When they make peace, we become the bad guys. Because we can't make peace. We're already at peace. So for us to make peace, we have to deny Jesus. We have to take the mark of the beast.
That's right.
You're not hearing me. See, they're going to make peace throughout the world. They're going to stop killing each other. And they're going to all join together and go, oh. And the world is just like, kumbaya, my Lord. Kumbaya. Kumbaya. Come on. They're going to make peace. But you understand that if you are a believer in Jesus Christ, if you're born again, they're going to back you into a corner and say, why aren't you a part of our peace? And I'm going to say, well, me and my children can't be a part of your peace, but we're already at peace. Jesus to join your club. I can't reject the Christ that saves me so that I can sing this song with you. And husband will hate wife, and father will hate son, and mom. Listen to me. And the end will come. And most believers, most of us sitting right here, are going to fall away. That's the scripture. Most of us will fall away from the faith. Because when it comes down to, can I feed my family or get my hand cut, I'll take the mark out of the village. I'm not. My family already knows. Okay. He saved my soul. He delivered me from my sin. He set me free. How can I deny him? But you understand that they're going to finally, all this that they've done, all this war, and all the, it's going to come, everybody's going to stop. A man of peace will rise up, bring it all together. Everybody's going to be singing a song. And you and I, all of a sudden, become the evil ones. You understand, isn't it crazy that right now, on your own news station, that religion that mutilates the genitals of women, a religion that still takes slaves and sells them as prostitutes. A religion that allows the men to rape little boys so they don't defile the girls. A religion that cuts your hand off or stones you to death for defiling the prophet. That on the news every night, there's silence about their evil. But you let Christians do something, and we're the bad guys about everything. You think that's by accident? A stop the evil because we're all at peace with each other. You think you're the bad guy now? You'll be the absolute bad guy then. You understand that the word church means this. Separate. If you're in the church of the Lord Jesus Christ, you've been separated from the world. You've been taken out from them and brought into Him. And this is what the world hates right now more than anything. It's simple. We've got to be all inclusive. We've got to be all unified. I can't unify with devils. I'm sorry, guys. I can't unify with sin. I can't unify with evil and darkness. I can't do it. I've been separated from the world. All right, so Christians have an open agenda. We didn't start with SPCA. SPCA, YMCA, prison reform, orphan care, hospital staff, feeding, clothing. See, our agenda is open. What we're about is open. Someone gets saved, filled with the Holy Ghost, and they go off to a place like Haiti to go take care of orphans.
Amen.
Someone gets saved, filled with the Holy Ghost, and they battle through cancer and come down every week to feed the hungry. Come on. Oh, I got a disease, and everybody worry about me. She's like, no, Pastor, I'm going to get well, and I'm coming down there working. Right. You see, empowered by the Spirit of God, remember, you shall receive power when the Holy Ghost comes on you. Power of the Holy Spirit, we're no longer about us and me, we're about them and Him.
Amen.
That's the difference. We have an open agenda. We're not hiding our agenda, we're not pretending. You see, a moderate Christian don't believe the Bible, but a Muslim don't believe the Quran. We're going to deal with that. So an open, born-again believer, we pass from death to life. We pass from dark to light. We pass from self to other. We pass from hate to love. We pass from selfishness and greed to generosity and blessing. We are transformed by the power of God's Spirit.
Amen.
Our agenda becomes open to all. We tell family and friends, I'm leaving y'all, Mom and Dad. I gotta go. I gotta call all my life and I gotta do something for Jesus. That's what happens to us when the power of God gets upon us. We leave all for the sake of the gospel. That's what happens to us. We don't strap bombs on our back. Did any of y'all strap bombs on your back, baby?
No.
But how many of y'all have fed the poor, clothed the naked, gave to those in need? It was so funny, back in 2012, in our election, they did a red state, blue state snapshot of charity. Listen, this is so interesting. Of charity giving. Okay? So, of course, there's two philosophies in America. Generalize this, but one philosophy is that the government takes care of us, and the other philosophy is we take care of us. I'm not defaming either one, I'm just saying there's two philosophies. One that believes the government's job is to take care of us, and the other one believes that we're a job to take care of us. And then, so one says the government needs to stay out of our business so we can take care of us, and the other one says no, government needs to be everywhere in our business so that you can't get over on it. So it says just to pull those above philosophies, political philosophies. So they took a snapshot of America. And so they used what they call red states and blue states. All right? And so you're looking at looking down on the nation, and the red states and the blue states, and the blue states were the ones that voted for the president, the red states voted for Mitt Romney. And so what they did is look at the charitable giving of the states that voted for the government to help people, and the charitable giving for the states that voted for people to help people. The average giving of a household in the states that voted for for the philosophy of government was 0.3% per household charity giving. 0.3% of the red states, charitable giving was 6%. You understand that those red states are also what's known as the Bible Belt. Now, and I'm not getting into politics about this. What I'm saying is that poll showed us that people, vital people, give. We're not waiting for the government to put some clothes on your back. We're going to give you some clothes. We're not waiting for the government to help you. We're going to go grab you out of prison and help you. Knowing that when Jesus changed him, now he's going to grab people out of prison and help them. Right? Our agenda, the point of that is our agenda is open. As Christians, we have an open agenda. I don't want to take over the world with a gun or a sword. I want to take over the world one heart at a time through Jesus Christ. I have an open agenda. We don't just have a children's church so kids can go back there and dance and have fun. We have a children's church for many reasons, but one of them is so that we can minister to the children of people who are not Christians so we can introduce them to Jesus Christ. I have an open agenda. I'm not hiding it. I want you to come to faith in Jesus Christ. I want you to be born again, filled with the Spirit, and have eternal life with Him in His kingdom.
Choice to do it.
can't tell you that your fornication and lying is okay. I can't tell you that your drunkenness and revelries are okay. I can't tell you that your gossip and backbiting is okay. I have to stand for the book. So if we stand for the book, getting closer to our God, we sin less and give more. Let's go over to Mr. Modern Islamic view. A moderate Islam God said, well, you know, we're not all murderers and killers and thieves. We don't really all enslave. And you know, we kind of like being in America, a secular society. And his preachers would say the same thing about him that I would say about a modern Christian. He's not a real Muslim. He doesn't believe the book. And they would reject him. Because the truth is, they have no choice. And the closer they get to their God, the more they have to kill. You can hear me. That's not politically correct. The closer they draw their, see, the closer we draw to our God, the more we die. The closer they draw to their God, the more they kill.
Amen.
I know, send me the emails later. Get mad all you want. I don't care. He has no choice because we read the verses. It tells him to do it. And when I was in prison, that spirit used grace to do this. But I wanted to let y'all know a little secret about the Bible. Give these gentlemen a hand, please. I want to let y'all in on a little secret. Next slide, please. The Bible doesn't say anything about race. Isn't that amazing? It talks about tribes, tongues, and nations. It never talks about race. The only few places the race, as far as the skin color, is noticed. It's either noticed in how lily white someone is, as in some passages, or how bronze and deep they are, or how dark and black like a Lebanon cedar now. It's never mentioned the way we mention it as a dividing between people. Because you understand that what makes someone what compare. Other than his good looks and nice physique. Other than his good looks and nice physique, you understand there's less than 0.001% difference between us and our genes.
All right.
It's just melanin. It's a chemical that releases called melanin. And the difference is so small, scientific. Shade of melanin. The difference is so statistically small, scientifically, that they really can't even hardly register in DNA as a statistical difference. It's 0.000, like 3 or 1%. When I was looking this up, and the Bible never mentions this. Nations, tongues, and tribes is what it mentions, but never mentions race as a dividing factor. Satan. Flesh uses race as a dividing factor. Sinfulness uses race as a dividing factor. But the Bible never recognizes race in that way. So, of course, when the whole interracial marriage thing came out, you know, a lot of people complained about it. And, well, if that's the case, then poor Moses would have been struck down by God. You know, he married a Midianite. You understand that what divides us is either your tribe, that group you like to hang out with. Now, that can be centered around color, but that's what you want to do. But that ain't the way God sees it. So what divides us is your tribe, the group you like to hang out with, to talk about other groups. We call them cliques in church, but you know what I'm saying. Your tribe, your tongue, tell you right now, if you went over to Spain, and you walk into a conference room, and everybody there speaks Spanish or Portuguese, and the best you can speak is barely some good Mexican English. You know what I'm saying? And you're walking in this room of 500 or 600 people, because this is what's so funny. You take someone like Brother George, and could you imagine you and Brother George like hanging out? You're dressed in nice day. Get you these dreads and some hip hop clothes, and Brother George and his dickies. And you two are gonna hang out in the mall somewhere. Would that be hilarious or what? That'd be pretty good. So imagine you walk into a room, and everybody in that room speaks a different language. You walk into one there, and the only person there that speaks your language. Everybody else looks like you there. They're all dread out, they're all, you know, jamming. But who do you even know? What? And then you run into this dude, and he speaks Mexican English. Who are you going to hang out with the rest of the night? Tribes. Also, as you find out, it deals with the way we are created as human beings. I want to close with this thought for my dear brothers and sisters here today, where everyone else is not. I want to close with this thought for you. Since we hold, therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things. I want you to know before you leave here that the only thing that can transform you, the only thing that can change you, the only thing that can save you is not an army, it's not a government, it's not your clan or your tribe or your tongue. The only thing that can save you is the only thing that transcends all of those. Stand your feet as we really close to us. So we'll give another hand clap of praise here. That you're more in the world than you're more in the kingdom, You're more about yourself than you are about Jesus. You're more about stuff than you are about souls. Today, the Lord's calling you home to come back to me and get back to what's important in life. Raise your hands. Father, in Jesus' name, I ask you to take each of those hands that are raised in the air and fill them today. Fill them with love and mercy and grace. Fill them with joy, oh God. Lord, call home the wayward sons and daughters. Lord, as if there's anyone here today who doesn't know you, who has not surrendered their lives to you, and cried out for your mercy and your forgiveness, and asked to be born again, Lord, I pray that they would come forth with boldness, desiring what only you can provide, which is new life. Father, we thank you for today. Lord, we thank you that your people are raising their children to love and forgive, to serve. Because, Lord, your goodness and your mercy, your Holy Spirit, your love shed abroad by those who have the Holy Spirit is the only good in this world. Father, I ask you to continue to use this church, this ministry, to feed the poor, to preach the good news to the lost, to clothe the naked, to visit the prisoner, to reach children of families who are lost and dying. Lord, use us afresh and anew to turn the world upside down for you, to reach Gates County for the glory of God in the name of Jesus in greater measure than we've ever done before. Lord, I ask you to do this through your people, for your kingdom, and I ask it in Jesus' name. And if you agree with it, say amen.
Amen.
God bless you as you go. Hug someone and tell them you love them before you leave here. Yeah, Mark Harper already told you, hug it today.